Next up, a session produced by our underwriter. Please welcome David Marin, Head of Government Affairs at Mylan.
Morning. So look, we don't really do this kind of thing very often, this underwriting thing, but this was a no-brainer. 12 years ago, Mylan wasn't even in the HIV field, but our leadership realized the desperate need for low-cost HIV drugs and made the decision to invest heavily in the space. Today, Mylan is the world's largest producer of HIV medicines. 40% of all people on treatment for HIV around the world use our products. That's about 8 million people every day. About 50% of our upstream production capacity goes toward HIV, even though it drives only about 5% of our overall revenues. We produce our HIV drugs across 9 different plants. Several of these are redundant because we know there's no plan B for the world's HIV patients if Mylan supply goes offline. It's a global battle. It's an unfinished fight. That's why we're honored to be part of today's discussion. And we're really grateful to have an incredible, compelling, spirited HIV survivor and thought leader with us today. Hers is a story worth hearing. Please join me in welcoming the acting director of the UNAIDS Washington Liaison Office and former editor of PAS, Regan Hofmann.
Thank you, Dave. Well, Dave and I are old family friends, and things you don't imagine in high school is that you will reconvene 25 years later in Washington to talk about AIDS, but it is my privilege to be here with you this morning, and I've been asked to speak a little bit about my personal story, which began in 1996. My mother and sister and I were in Florida swimming with the dolphins. My mom had given us a dolphin for Christmas, and we went down to the Dolphin Research Center, and while standing on the dock contemplating getting in the water with this giant mammal with teeth, I was thinking it was not a good idea at that time. I looked down and noticed that I had a swollen bump on my leg by my groin. And I went back to my doctor and asked him what it could be. And he said, we're going to run some tests. And by the way, we'll run an HIV test. And I had been tested for HIV. I grew up in the 80s and was aware of it. So I didn't think about it until they called me a week later and said, can you please come back? Your blood work is inconclusive. We need to do some more testing. So they put me into an exam room, and I waited for about 25 minutes, and they said, the doctor's running late, it's crowded, can you please sit in his personal room? So they put me in a Lazy Boy recliner, and the door banged open, and 5 people in lab coats walked in. And the first thing I thought was, oh my God, I got something terrible from the dolphins. And, you know, they've sent in a squadron of people to tell me what's going on. And I was worried about being quarantined, ironically. And they said, we don't know how to tell you this. They were GPs, but we're going to just let you have it straight. You know, you have HIV. And I was 28 at the time, and I said, so how long do I have? And they said, 1 year, maybe 2. And I said, can I have sex? And they said, no. And they also, then I asked if I could have a baby, because I don't know why I thought I could have a baby if I couldn't have sex, but I did want to leave some part of myself behind for my family. You have very irrational thoughts in this moment. And it's easy for me to joke about it now, but of course it was traumatizing. And I went home, and you know, it's weird. You imagine these moments maybe in your life, but you just do weird, normal things. I made pasta. I didn't know what else to do. But after a couple of hours, I finally had the courage to go into the bathroom and look myself in the face. And I stood there and I said, well, how could you let this happen to you? You had been careful. You are well educated. You know better. How could you let this happen to you? But the truth was, I didn't think I was really at risk. So I didn't tell anyone for a while, but eventually I couldn't handle it alone, and so I saw an ad for the Gay Men's Health Crisis and called them, and I said, I'm not gay and I'm not a man, but I'm definitely in crisis, and they were very helpful and directed me to a gay men's health group in my hometown, actually, which I didn't know existed. And I have gay men to thank for my life. I mean, the activism was led in this country in the early 80s by largely the gay community, gay men and women, and straight men and women, but they took me in. And one of the things that struck me in those days of being together was how sad it was that, you know, any other disease that you get flowers, you have someone come walk your dog, they go with you to the doctor, they ask you how you're feeling, but with HIV, you just get thrown out of society, you're a pariah, and you haven't done anything. You've contracted a virus, a retrovirus, right? But suddenly, I've been lucky in life, and I did not know what it was like to be hated and shunned and thrown away by society just for a fact of your life that you can't control. That was unbelievably painful. And So I was humiliated and stigmatized and terrified, and I didn't tell my family. I did tell my past partners, which is something that, of course, is necessary, but not a series of phone calls anyone wants to make. And as we look at different ways of testing today, we have looked at new modalities for helping people tell their network of partners, which I think is a really good idea. But eventually, I did tell my family. I thought, you know, if I had a child and they were dying, I would want to know that I had tried to do something before they passed away. So I told my mother, which was really the most difficult thing I've done in my life. And it was like standing beside her when she found my dead body. I mean, the sound that she made, and she's a very composed woman, was terrifying. She told my sister, I met my sister's my best friend, and I saw her all the way down the train platform when she came home to see me. And I could tell that she knew because she just had this way of being. And she walked right up to me and she said, "Don't you worry, we're gonna kick this thing." And we went to Burger King and we made this big lake of ketchup like we usually did, and she just dipped her fries in it and didn't even look back. And I thought, you know, that was the first moment that I felt that I was gonna maybe be okay with this. Another moment was years later when she handed me her newborn son and said, "Wash him." And I was like, okay, this is such a bad idea on so many levels, but not because of HIV. I just didn't know how to wash a baby. My father was fantastic, and I had that kind of support. But I really didn't tell anybody for about 10 years. Of course, I didn't die because I'm here. And in 96, we realized the drugs were going to work. I survived, and I started to feel survivor responsibility. I really had been one of the lucky ones and wanted to do something to make sure other people didn't get this, and that those who had it would have a similar access to care and support. So I started writing anonymously for a magazine called PAWS, which was for people living with HIV, which we took global and digital, and found that there were people all over the world, in the underground, in Russia, in the Middle East, everywhere, who were not actually getting access to care information. So we did what we could about that. And then after reporting on HIV, began to appreciate the value of the policy making and how that impacted the work that we could do, and of course the funding. So I wanted to be closer to the nerve center, and did advocacy on the edges of my job at PAWS as a journalist, and then eventually came to work for the UN here in Washington. And I work with many people in this room, and it's a privilege to work with all of you. But, you know, I've thought a lot about what we need to do about stigma, and I think the bottom line is we need to think about this disease as a disease and remind people it's a retrovirus that affects your immune system. That's all it is. And we need to go back to the basic facts of biology and help people understand that until we normalize it, as the gentleman here was saying, we can't do what we know we can do. We've come so far. We still have a lot of people left to reach. The new data out from UNAIDS shows that we've got about half of all people living with HIV on treatment, but only about half of them are virally suppressed. And we still have a lot of people we have left behind. So we will get there. I do think it's possible. One quick anecdote. You know, when I first went home to live with my mom, none of us knew what to do. And I had my own stick of butter in the fridge because I didn't want to give her HIV, and we didn't know that I was virally suppressed and therefore non-infectious. And we washed my sheets in bleach. We liked to do things that we felt like would do something. It was unnecessary, but we did it. She's coming for Christmas in a couple weeks, and it's 20 years later. And she said, "Don't go to any fuss. And don't even, I have two bedrooms, but one of them is my office, and she's gonna sleep in my bed." And she said, "You don't even need to change the sheets." And I thought, you know, we've come a very long way to that point where she's happy to sleep in my sheets. And I just, you know, huge thanks to Mylan, to The Atlantic for promoting this issue on World AIDS Day. The media plays a huge role, obviously, in helping us remind people that this is still an issue. And thank you to all of you who are doing all of this work. You're saving millions of people's lives. And, you know, it's a long journey, but it's a possible journey. And there are a lot of people out there who, you know, in the work that I do with UNAIDS, I travel the world. They ask me, you know, is more help on the way? Are they going to come to us? You know, will this continue? And I am forever an optimist. And I see bright people and very dedicated people all over the city and all over the world. And I know we can reach everybody. So thank you for the work that you're doing.